Savior's God, victory.
Hello from all of us here at the City. We are looking forward to welcoming you back here again.
Please give us your attention as we bring you through this important safety video.
Upon arrival, you'll be greeted by one of our friendly ushers at level 1. Simply present your ticket to our ushers. If you are bringing a friend or your children along, please present their tickets as well.
Parents with children above the age of 4 should lead them to our children's church at level 5 before heading up for the service. Our safety ambassador will take their temperature and a GUS teacher will check them in. Avoid lingering behind after dropping off your child.
When you arrive at level 6, please stand by your TraceTogether app or token. Scan the QR code or present your token to one of our safety ambassadors who will also assist in taking your temperature before you enter the auditorium.
Please be patient as our ushers will assign you a seat with an assigned sticker. You may be more comfortable to choose a seat with friends or people from your life group, but why not take this opportunity to open up your heart and to get to know other members of the church?
When assigned to a seat, please remain seated and avoid mingling across the aisle or heating it up in the washroom. While you may not be able to sing, you are able to worship the King of Kings with your hands and body response, with the thoughts of your mind and a meditation of your heart. You may also pray and speak in tongues.
Please be reminded to keep your mask on at all times. Hand sanitizers can be found in various points of the worship venue.
As the service comes to an end, we pray that you would have encountered God's goodness, His peace and grace. You will be released in sections, starting with the one closest to the exits. Please remain in your seats till your section is called.
Parents, please leave according to the assigned section before heading down to pick up your child. Remember to keep a safe distance from other members of the church and avoid loitering after picking them up.
For more information, please refer to the slides on the screen or just approach any of our friendly ushers or staff team.
And on behalf of Team City, we hope you have a safe and blessed time here.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Let's all rise and let's give the Lord a big hand clap this morning. We praise you, Lord. We glorify you. Right, let's go.
Your name is love, a love that always finds. Here with you, so have your way. to be where you are, Lord. Now and forever, it's more than a song. My one desire is to be with you, is to be with you.
Just invite us, just take a moment, just the music. And just focus on just your heart connecting with the heart of God. That truly, God, this is my desire. And where our singing is limited, we bear our hearts before you, God. You know, even in these times when we're not like, you know, able to sing uninhibited, and yet our hearts can be totally bared before God. That it's this inward thing that says, yes, God, I yearn and I long for you and your presence. That it's not just in the words or volume of our songs, but that with all of our hearts, we turn to Him and we attend to Him, His presence. And so God, this morning, we say all of our, the whole of our beings, my whole being, from the depths of my soul, I turn to you. Not just my physical eyes, like looking at the lyrics, but Lord, my all of me, my insides yearn for you and long for you, your nearness. That God, without you we starve, we thirst for you. We are like parched lands. We are like that deer searching for water. We thirst and long after you, and there is none that satisfies short of you. And so Lord, this morning we acknowledge our lack, our need for you. And so as your people this morning, we come to your table. We come and say yes to all that you want to do in our midst. Just this morning, you may have noticed on your seats the communion elements, right? It's Communion Sunday today. In a minute, I'll ask us to partake it of together. Now, our time of communion is so significant because it's a way that we remember this powerful act of love and mercy that Jesus has done for us on the cross. In its totality, not just as an act of remembrance, but communion is also a means of grace where we as God's people continue to mature and be united as His body, the body of Christ. And through communion, it's significant and powerful because it's also a way of us looking forward to become that bride of Christ in that day and join with God at that banquet table. Right? It's such a significant act. And so even in this time, I invite you to take a moment to examine your hearts before Him in His presence. That we do not take this lightly. It's not flippant for us. But we come to the table with seriousness and with hearts desiring repentance. And we recognize our need before Him. That Lord, we come and we say, Lord, would you examine my heart? If there be any way not pleasing in me, God, would you show me? And God, even in this moment, I ask, Lord, forgive me for ways I've strayed, Forgive me for ways I have departed from your ways, and I have left my love for you. God, our hearts are contrite before you, that only you can illuminate for us where we fall short. And that is where we receive your righteousness for us. And so in that, and upon that righteousness we stand this morning. We come to your throne of grace because you have made us righteous before you. Thank you, Lord. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took up the bread, he gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." And in that same way, Jesus took up the cup and he said, "This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink in remembrance of me." Amen. Let's take the communion. Give you a moment to pray to God on your own before I lead us in a prayer together. Okay, would you pray this with me on the screen? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him, who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, and will also give us all things with him. Therefore shall my mouth and heart show forth the praise of the Lord from this time forth forevermore. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Oh, come on. Give praise properly. Loud. Praise Jesus. Lord, we thank you for not just your work on the cross, but your continual work until today and the days forward in our lives. Amen. Amen. All right. Please be seated, church. Welcome each other. Turn around and say hi to somebody that you may not be very familiar with, or you may be very familiar with, whichever. Say hi, greet each other. Morning. Hi, my name is Janice, and I'm one of the staff here at the city. A very big warm welcome to everyone. Say hi. I need to get some energy in the room. Hi, good morning. Say hello. Those of you who are online, glad that you can visit us. In a moment, we'd love to welcome, if you're a newcomer, you're visiting, all right? I hope to have you raise your hand so we can acknowledge. Now, here at the city, we exist to help all people be with Jesus, become like Jesus, and do the works of Jesus in our city, right here. And we do this through these three core pursuits of tangible presence, resilience, discipleship, and missional communities. That's what we're about here. So if you're visiting and you're new, would love to have you raise your hand right where you're seated. If there's any one of you, you're visiting for the first time. Hi, we've got a bag coming at you over here. We've got a connect card in the bag where we'd love to get you to fill in your details, and you can pass that card back to us through the offering bucket in a minute. Anyone else who's new, welcome. Hi. Okay. How about those who are online, if you are also a guest visiting us, we also want to warmly welcome you. Please do drop us a message, either Facebook or Instagram. We'd love to get to know you on our YouTube as well, right? Now, okay, let me come to announcements. Say announcements! Wow. Okay, just three announcements. First up, baptism. Now, we're preparing for water baptism on 17 April, and this is a way for you as a follower of Jesus to declare, hey, I want to, I am a follower of Jesus, and I want this to be, the rest of my life, right? My commitment to God. And so if you have not been water baptized and you're a follower of Jesus, this is your opportunity. Do register your interest either email at hello@thecity.sg or on our app, The City app, if you would like to be water baptized. Take note, we've got two baptism classes before 17th of April, and those are on the 3rd of April and 10th April. 3rd April and 10th April at 2 p.m. at church, all right? Second is, as we've mentioned last Sunday, but just making sure that we hear this again, we're looking and forward to preparing for this Lent series called Jesus is Better. We're going to embark on it 13 March onwards. It's going to be 6 weeks where we look at snapshots on Jesus' life and, you know, his life, his example, his teaching, and how that really just challenges us and our perceptions and our priorities in life. So with this Lent series, we're preparing our hearts in repentance and humility towards Resurrection Sunday, Easter, right? So be sure to be tracking with this. You can find out more resources on our Lent page at www.thecity.sg/Lent. Third announcement, all right, is we are calling for life group leaders. Woo! Yes! Yes! Life group leaders! Would you stand up? No. So, those of you who are life group leaders, you know, this is a great privilege and together just a role to be serving our community, right? And so we're calling for new groups and new leaders in the season. We would love to come alongside those of you who have interest. So please do check out information on this website, thecity.sg/lifegroups, where you can read a bit about life groups. There's a guide on how to get started. You can indicate your interest and the dates for our next training for life group leaders. So please do check out this website, because we'd love to have more groups and new leaders emerge. So if you have questions, feel free to talk to any of the life group leaders or myself, right, Janice? All right, so let's transition now to a time of giving. You know, when we give, it's an invitation for us to come and say once more, not just once in a while, but as a habit, as a rhythm of saying, yes, God, shape me, you know, in your likeness, in your generosity. So as we give this morning, may that be our posture of cheerful giving, reflecting the Father, right? And as we call you to give, you can take out your banking app and scan the QR code right in the seat in front of you, because the one on the TV will be hard to scan. You can also raise your hand for buckets to come round if you'd like to give physically. Please feel free to raise your hand so that we can have our team come with the buckets. All right. For more information on giving, you can also check out our website on the giving page. Let me pray, and then those who would like to give physically, you can raise your hand. Father, we come. We say that we, as your people, long for your presence, even as we've sung, and we come to your table, and we say we experience your hospitality towards us through this communion we've just partaken. And even so, Lord, we say, even right here, in your presence, shape us in your likeness of generosity, of mercy, of compassion, that as we give, that it's not just a giving that is not touching our hearts, but that is from our heart that we give, because we long for more to be blessed and for your kingdom, your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. So with that, we say, yes, take all that we are giving and multiply it for your purposes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Anyone like to give physically? Please do raise your hand. This morning, we are having our last sermon on this series, That You May Pray. How many of you have been just, you know, tracking with this and you've been just stirred in your prayer life? Right? Some? We've been just encouraged and inspired to, you know, understand prayer more and to experience it more, isn't it? Yeah, so this morning, I am excited for what Pastor Andre has to share with us. And I know that you're going to be blessed. So open your hearts and just let God's Spirit speak to us. Amen. Let's welcome him, Pastor Andre.
Good morning. How are y'all doing?
Good.
Good, good, good. Well, as Pastor Janice mentioned, we are, you know, in the Lenten season, not just as a church, but as a church globally, this is a 40-day period of observance, of posturing our hearts, our minds in this act of repentance, of penance, of seeking. And it's really significant in not just church calendar, but I believe in the lives of believers. So I want to encourage you to check out our resources, thecity.sg/Lent. And if you're looking for some kind of Lenten devotional, you can check out Pastor Genesis' Instagram and EXO's Instagram. They are on day 3 and day 4 now. And so by me saying this, they are committed to doing all 40 days. You cannot lax. Or else, you know, people can't do their devotional. That's how it feels, you know, when you do the daily, right? You know, sometimes, well, 没有了, then it's like, people like, oh, my devotional is dependent on you, which is not the right posture, by the way. Well, folks, I do have a lot ground to cover. I have somewhat of an exciting slash challenging slash, you know, real life-giving, but I believe tricky message to get into in just a bit. But I want to take some time this morning to announce a transition in leadership. Now, our worship team, many of you have been blessed by worship team, yeah? Yeah, and so this morning, we are announcing a transition in worship ministry leadership. We have new heads of ministry. So can I invite Desmond and then our new heads of ministry, Chris and Song, will join me up front. Oh, right, man. Now, well, these are the new heads of ministry and Desmond. Well, many of us know Desmond. Do we all know Desmond? Yes. We see him around. Desmond is known by many names. Laopan, Laudes, Despacito, Lesman, Alpacades, and now more recently, Guitar Uncle. Yeah. And so, contrary to what some of you might believe, Desmond's not leaving us to pursue a new influencer career. But, you know, it's really in his heart to transition a ministry in good standing to a next generation of leaders. And I can't think of two better ones to lead us in this time. Now, Desmond, when I first approached him some 6 years ago, I think 6 years really. 6 years ago, I went to him, and I wish I can tell you it was a spirit-led moment, like I just had his face come up in my dream. But no, it was just like, I went, Desmond, please lead the ministry. And I remember one of his responses was, I'm just a muso, I'm just a simple man. I'm not pastoral, and I cannot do any of this pastoral thing. And I want to say to you in front of everyone, that's a lie in a pit of hell, because you are one of the most pastoral persons I've ever met in my life. And not just pastor in the sense of kind and you know, loving, but pastor in the sense of, like, you know, a willingness to confront in love, to offer grace where grace is needed, to challenge, to disciple. And I just want to call that out in you. I just want to recognize that in you and recognize the amazing work they've done with our worship teams. And really, you know, much of what you see and experience today and just witness, you know, it's a real testament, of course, to the Spirit's work, but a lot of it, you know, it comes from Desmond's labor. And so to the two that are receiving this charge, you are receiving the ministry in good hands and in good standing. And we trust that the greater days are ahead of us as a church. Now, I'd love to pray a scripture over you, even as you receive this appointment. There's this verse in 1 Chronicles chapter 17, verse 4, and it says this, that David appointed some Levites to lead the people in worship before the ark of the Lord, that's his presence, to invoke his blessings, to give thanks, and to praise God, the Lord of Israel. And so that is what we are appointing you both to do, to function in that Levitical tradition of leading the people of God before His presence, to invoke His blessing, to praise Him. And, you know, we have leadership transitions in different ministries all the time, but with the worship ministry, it's especially significant because this is very much a spiritual role. And you want to recognize that this is not something trivial or easy or light, but the burden is heavy. And I trust that both of them have, you know, count the cost, they have weighed it all, and now they are paying the price. And so I want to commend them for that and extend our blessing toward them. So can I invite us, church, to extend your hands toward them as we pray. Well, Father, first of all, we recognize Desmond and his heart of service and love towards our community. We just want to extend a blessing to Desmond. Thank you for how you have used him to be such a blessing in our community, how you used him to not just be a service in music, but in the lives of people, and how he, through his kindness and hospitality, have transformed the hearts of people. And so we want to recognize that. We pray that the days ahead of him will not diminish in purpose, but be filled with new purpose in your name. Lord, we pray for Zhongwei and Chris, even as they take on this appointment. Lord, we pray that this day be significant, that they will experience a fresh unction, anointing, and infilling of the Holy Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name now that you'll fill them with the Holy Spirit afresh, to inspire fresh vision, a fresh unction, a fresh sense, God, of what you are doing in our community and in our world. Lord, we recognize that this is very much a spiritual appointment, so we invite you, Holy Spirit, to be upon them even now. And Lord, as your people, we submit to their leadership. In times of worship, as they lead us, we submit to them. We recognize this appointment. And of God's people say, Amen. 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 Now I'm presenting both of your Bibles, you know, new Bibles, clean and no highlights, which is the way I like it. But it's so that, you know, you will lead us, you know, to worship in spirit and in truth. And Desmond, your presence on the way. It's still on the way. I want to give you like Lee Kuan Yew's book, you know, Our Singapore Story, because he said to me that he's not leaving in that sense where he's going to be a mentor, ministry mentor kind of role. And every now and then, he's going to come in and say, I am here to bring the house back to earth. And so, you trust that that doesn't need to happen too often. But anyway, thank you guys. You may be seated. Isn't that beautiful? If you don't know, I'm going to be an uncle. Going to be uncle soon. Anybody? No? Yeah. People don't get the Instagram. Never mind. It's okay. But yes. Well, folks, I have a lot of ground to cover. And so are you all with me? Yes? Pee already? Drink a coffee already? All right. Let's get started. As I get started, now I'll share a funny story, a funny update in my family. As you know, Sage turned one in January, and she is all sorts of a bag of tricks these days. Really, really fun to be around. And she's starting to develop, you know, in speech, and so she's able to say certain words. Very interesting choice of words. Dada is definitely there, but Mama is nowhere there. And she's able to identify different animals these days. Her favorite is lion. And so she would point at a you know, picture of a lion and go, lion, lion, lion. And so she's able to identify not just the names of animals, but the sound that they make. And so her favorite cow, she'll go moo moo, dog, she'll go wo wo, and then a horse, she'll go nay nay, or sometimes it sounds like nene. And so the interesting story is some weeks ago she fell sick and I needed to bring her to the clinic, and I was on my own. It was my first time bringing her to the clinic on my own, and so I brought her in, and the clinic was just full of like pictures of animals, and so she was just loving it. She was like, lion, lion, couch. Then she was like, moo moo, moo moo, whoa whoa, and then, so she was just going around, and then at one point she turned and looked at the nurse behind the counter, and she looked at her, and then she said, nene. And so the nurse, in hearing that loud exclamation, it was loud enough for the whole clinic to hear. She went like this. No, Nene is not here. Nene not here. And then I turned and looked at the nurse and went, oh, no, no, no. She doesn't mean that. She means horse. And then the nurse kept quiet and looked around and she's like, there's no horse here. And so at that point in time, I wanted to leave the clinic and just self-medicate. And I whispered to her, I was like, come on, play it cool. Why? Why? Why, Sage? Why? Now, I bring up that story because it's somehow related to the talk that I have for you this morning. It involves speech, language, interpretation, and someone getting offended. Today, I'll be speaking to you on the subject of spiritual language, specifically praying in tongues. Praying in tongues, that's the topic for today. And I don't bring it to you as a means of, you know, division or confusion, but you know, I can't help but echo the words of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians when he says, "I wish that all of you spoke in tongues." You know, there's no other spiritual practice that I have on the daily that has been as life-giving as praying in tongues, praying in the Spirit. And that is my pastoral heart for all of you as a community, that all of you would pray in the Spirit. It's what I wish for and it's what I long for. And so today, you know, we'll be speaking on this subject. Now, if you grew up in, you know, the charismatic or Pentecostal tradition like I did, tongues is like a non-issue, right? We see it in our gatherings. It's very much a part of our prayer life. You know, you're a tongue-praying machine. So this is like not for you at all. Today, you know, I'm more specifically speaking to three groups of people. First group of people is this. You know, you have, in the language of the New Testament, the gift of tongues. You have the gift of tongues, but you rarely put it into practice. The only time you pray in tongues is maybe in a gathering like this or when there's a call for intense prayer. It's not so much a part of your life. You have the gift, but you rarely put it into practice. The second group of people that I love to speak to are people who, you know, read the words of scripture and see, you know, people praying in tongues ecstatically and they go, "I want that so much, but I don't have it." You want the gift of tongues, but you don't have it. The third group of people that I love to speak to through this message are people who are on the fence. They're skeptical about tongues. They have all these questions like, is tongues really a real thing? It sounds like gibberish. It sounds, you know, made up, you know. It sounds, you know, so weird. And is it even for today? You know, are the gifts even for today? I'd love to speak to that group of people as well. Now, I've come to realize this, that in Christendom, whenever there's a particular aspect or theme in God's kingdom that has a lot of opposition, confusion, and division around it, it's often a veiled attempt from the enemy to distract the people of God. And he distracts the people of God because there's tremendous blessing and life to be found in such themes. For example, money. For example, generosity. There's so much division and confusion surrounding it. But Jesus has so much to say about the allure of wealth in pulling us away from faithfully following him as disciples. But he also talks so much about the blessing that comes when people of God learn to live loosely with their resource. He's able to bless them. The enemy, I like to put it to you, doesn't spend energy on things that don't matter, but on realities that can potentially harm and destroy his kingdom. That is why I believe the subject of a prayer language, praying in tongues, is under so much distress. There's so much warfare and confusion surrounding it. And so I'm led to ask a few questions as we begin this morning. Could it be that the gift that has stirred probably some of the greatest debate and division within the body of Christ is actually one of the greatest keys in unlocking the power of God in the church in these last days? Could it be that the devil has, in a way, worked overtime to make this a point of contention because he understands the power that it will release? And as a people, we often, you know, underestimate the power of these languages. Now, you can probably tell there's a lot of work to do, folks. So let's get started. As always, reading to you a couple passages of scripture before we enter into a time of prayer together. Reading first off from Acts chapter 2. This is the word of the Lord. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Notice this, as the Spirit enabled them. It wasn't something learned or imitated. It was as the Spirit enabled them. Reading down further. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, the sound of wind and people praying in other tongues, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all those who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language. Reading also from 1 Corinthians chapter 14 says this in God's word, follow the way of love and eagerly desire gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. For anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to people but to God. Indeed, no one understands them. They utter mysteries by the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Now, before I go on further, I would like us to remember and kind of frame this exploration. This series that we're on is about prayer. And prayer, simply at its root, is this, you know, act of love and intimacy and connection before God, our Father. And so today, we aren't so much just talking about a manifestation of the Spirit or a gift of the Spirit. We're talking about a means of grace, a pathway towards experiencing a depth of love and intimacy. And Jesus, through His Spirit, has given us this means of grace, this pathway. And don't we all desire to experience that depth of intimacy and love with God? And so the question we are more inclined to explore today is, what will it look like for all of us to walk in a greater depth and intimacy with God, our Father? So today, my message for us is this, praying in tongues. Very simple, no fancy, praying in tongues. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Jesus, we remind ourselves in this act of prayer of who we are talking to. Lord, we are praying to You, the one whose Spirit moved in that upper room on that very day, the day of Pentecost. The same Spirit that breathed life, that descended upon the 120 in the upper room, is here in this room now. We recognize that. We honor You, King Jesus. And Lord, we recognize that there's so much confusion and doubt and uncertainty surrounding what we're about to explore. And God, I thank You that truth is not discovered nor born through research or through extensive study, but God, it is Your Spirit that leads us into all truth. So Holy Spirit, we invite You here, far beyond the words of men, the depth of research, the eloquence, the preacher. We invite You, Spirit, to move upon the hearts of Your people this day. Lead us into all truth, we pray. In Your name, amen. Now, first of all, I want us to not just come to a kind of baseline understanding of what we're talking about, this tongues that we're talking about. The word tongues is this Greek word glossa, and it more accurately kind of translates to languages. And so it sounds kind of like iffy and far out, but tongues simply mean languages. And so I have a few definitions up for you this morning as we begin. First off, from John Mark Comer, he says this, tongues are a form of prayer and praise you express to God in a language that you do not understand. N.T. Wright, a brilliant New Testament scholar, says this about tongues. It is the gift of speech which, through making sounds and using apparent or even actual languages, somehow bypasses the speaker's conscious mind. And the last one is from a book, it's a definition of tongues. It says this, it can be a known or unknown language. It can be used evangelistically. Tongues can be used to authenticate the addition of new people into God's church. Tongues can be used for edification. Tongues can be used to worship God by singing in tongues, to pray for others, to be thankful, to give inner assurance of communion with God, an affirmation of personal presence of God in your life. This gift can bring you joy, allows you to cry out to God over others when words do not come. You can be deeply changed and moved by this gift. This is a few definitions of what tongues is. Now, tongues is often heard in this environment, in times of, especially of intense prayer and of singing. We hear tongues all the time, and that is what tongues is this kind of, you know, language, sometimes known, sometimes unknown, that bypasses the conscious mind, that allows us to express to God in ways that no mere human language cannot. You know, it allows us to enter into a deep posture of prayer. It allows us to sing to God, you know, in what Paul would describe as spiritual songs. This is tongues. Now, Paul would say this in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Follow the way of love. Eagerly desire the gift of the Spirit, especially prophecy. Anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to people but to God. Indeed, no one understands them. They utter mysteries by the Spirit. So we learn three things about tongues in this short little verse. The first is this. Tongues involve speaking to God and to not each other. Paul would say this. The one who has tongues does not speak to people but to God. Tongues are to God and not each other. The second thing is this, it is mysterious. It transcends our human understanding. It lays outside of what we are able to comprehend. That is, neither the speaker nor the hearer in many instances know what is being said. Tongues are mysterious. And the third thing is this, that tongues can but don't need to be a known human language. Now, within the scope of 1 Corinthians 14, it is said that tongues cannot be understood. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 says this, that Paul would pray or speak in the tongues of men and of angels. And so we gather here a few conclusions. The first is this, tongues can be intelligible human languages and it can be an unintelligible angelic language. It can be an understandable human language, but it can also be an ununderstandable angelic language. The former warrants translation and the latter warrants interpretation. So I have that. I have a list of definitions or variants of tongues. The first is this: it's an intelligible human language that is previously unknown to the speaker that is used for the proclamation of the gospel. We'll get to that shortly. The next is this: it's an unintelligible prayer language that edifies the speaker. No one understands what is being said, but the scripture tells us that when we pray in this angelic language, that the self is edified, is built up. We'll get into that later. And the third is this, it is an unintelligible prayer that requires the gift of interpretation for the building and edification of the church. This comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Now, when I was building out this sermon, you know, I had in mind to do a verse-by-verse exposition of 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And let me just ruin it for you. There are 40 verses there. It's immensely complex. And then by the time I was done doing all of that, I realized that you'll be here until like 1:30 at least. And so I'm not going to do that this morning. I'm going to put it maybe in another paper that we release. But you know, there's so much in there that talks about the order of worship and how tongues is to be expressed in a gathering like this. And some of it is contextual. Some of it, I believe, has relevance in our day and age. But I'd just like to make a simple point, and that is this, that we don't often see and hear the gift of interpretation because much of the church has neglected the order, the way of love that Paul describes in that text. And I think, you know, that we can come a certain ways in, you know, making more room in our services for that gift to be expressed and manifested in our midst. So that's just a side little thing. Now, some today dismiss tongues as just mere gibberish, like senseless babbling that has little to no value, that is for the seemingly unintellectual and uneducated. And yet Paul, as a trained Pharisee, you know, he would have, by estimate, some 20 years of college-level education. This was a man deeply steeped, not just in culture, but in knowledge. He was a very highly educated man. He was the cream of the crop. And yet, Paul would say this in 1 Corinthians 14, 18. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. Paul, as a highly educated man, as someone who, you know, what many will regard as second to Jesus in establishing the New Testament church, saw it fitting and right to pray in tongues, not just on occasion, but regularly, frequently, as a part of his life. Now, the gift of tongues is a New Testament distinctive, folks. The nine gifts of the Spirit listed in 1 Corinthians 12, all of them are mentioned somewhat in Old Testament, except two: the gift of tongues and the interpretation of tongues. And this, you know, this kind of distinctive is not, I would like to put it to you, it's not just a New Testament distinctive, not just a Pentecostal distinctive, it is a New Testament distinctive. And I will go on further to explain that. Now, the first time we see the gift of tongues present in the book of Acts chapter 2, the text that we read earlier, it kind of describes not just the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, but the birth of the church. This is when the church was born on the day of Pentecost. Corey Russell would say this about that day. On the morning of that feast day, a group of young fishermen most still only teenagers, stumble out of that upper room, looking drunk and babbling in other languages. Think about this, if you were God and could use anything as a vehicle to release your will, desires, and purposes into the world, how would you have birthed a church on the day of Pentecost? Really, how would you have done it? Where would you have placed your greatest resources of strength, wisdom, power, and wealth? And what spiritual gift would you have released to mark the beginning of the apostolic era? The truth is that most of us would probably not have made the choice that God did. He birthed his church in tongues. Now, when we read the text earlier, we can gather that five things happened almost simultaneously on that day. First, a loud and fierce wind filled the house. And then it said that it appeared that there was almost like divided tongues of fire that began to descend on each believer. And then it was said that they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And then following that, they begin to speak in this language of what, you know, the writer, what Luke would describe as other tongues. And the fifth thing that happened was foreigners and strangers, which were around the vicinity, heard praise to God in their own native tongue. And you read all of Acts chapter 2, it's pretty amazing. Luke lists, you know, some of the widespread linguistic origins of the crowd, and it lists some 15 geographical areas with their unique languages and all these languages being heard on that day. And so God in this moment was enabling these first Christians by giving them this divine ability to speak all at once in many languages that they do not know, in order to begin the process of bringing the world back to God through Jesus and his people. Now, beyond this phenomenal spiritual experience, as amazing as it is, there was actually something deeper, a more profound grace that was released in this moment. In Genesis chapter 11, taking you back, we read that at one point, humanity had one language. They had one language, and it's said in the scripture that they were set on building a city with a tower that connects heaven and earth. And it was said that they longed to do so so that they could make a name for themselves. And so, hear me. Humanity, one language, united with a singular purpose to make a name for themselves. And God declared that because they had one language and that they were united in their efforts, Genesis 11, 6 will say this, that nothing will be withheld from them. In some translations, it translates to nothing is impossible for them because they were united in one language, they were united in motive, in desire, nothing will be withheld from them. And we read that further that God began to confuse the human language and disperse the nations over the face of the earth. We read this in this text. So the Lord scattered them from there over all the earth and they stopped building the city. That's why it's called Babel. Interesting, right? You know, when you make sounds that nobody understands, you call it babbling. Maybe, I don't know. Yuchen, you think? Yeah, I think so. Because there the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth. And so at this point, they could not understand each other. They could not, you know, be united in purpose. And so they stopped building and they were no longer of one mind, of one language. And everything ceased. And I believe this is an act of God's mercy, so he didn't have to judge them by the severity of their sin. God's mercy brought confusion. So fast forward, folks, to Acts chapter 2. We see somehow, somewhat precisely, the reverse happening in Acts chapter 2, don't we? Where at Babel, God broke the unity of men and fractured their bond as an act of grace to preserve them from judgment. At Pentecost, this language barrier was overcome. The people of God was united in a way by one language, the language of the Spirit. And they were united with this commission that Jesus had given them as a sign that God is now saying over his people that the curse, the judgment of Babel has been reversed. And now you, people of God, are united through this gift of tongues, through this spiritual language, and united by the commission. Now go therefore and make disciples of all nations. It was a reversal. Someone, you know, at Babel, I like to put it to you, earth proudly tried to ascend to heaven, while at Pentecost, heaven humbly descended to earth. It's a divine reversal. Now, this was not a one-off occurrence in Acts chapter 2. We see two other instances in the book of Acts where tongues was mentioned. Are you all with me, folks? Yes. If you're familiar with scripture, you know, the next passage of scripture we're going to go to is Acts chapter 10. And so your familiar scripture, you'll know that Acts chapter 10 is a really significant chapter in the Bible. This is kind of like the fulcrum point, the point where the gospel moves outside of its ethnic boundary, moves beyond the ethnic boundary of Judaism, and it moves into the Greco-Roman culture. We read about the spread of the gospel beyond the borders of Israel into the Gentile community. And so, folks, how many of you are Jewish here? How many of you are Gentiles, non-Jewish? Every one of you? Yeah, the reason why you're here is because of this story that you're about to read. Okay? So it says this in verse 44, chapter 10. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers, aren't you thankful that we don't have those categories anymore? Like, circumcised people? And okay, never mind. Who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on Gentiles. For they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Notice, similar to Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit came upon man, came upon flesh, they began to speak in tongues. Next passage of scripture in Acts chapter 19 says this, while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples and asked them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? They answered, no, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. They missed the sermon series that way, so they're like, who's this Holy Spirit guy? And so Paul asked, then what baptism do you receive? They replied, John's baptism. And so these people weren't really believers. And Paul said John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. He told the people to baptize in the one coming after him, that is, in Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesy. Same thing as Acts 2, as Acts 10. When the Holy Spirit came upon flesh and men, they began to speak in tongues. Now, just a cursory reading of Acts alone will cause us to conclude that this is what happens when the Holy Spirit comes upon men and flesh. They begin to speak in these tongues or these other tongues. Jesus himself would say that speaking in tongues would mark and distinguish his followers. In Mark chapter 16, it says, they shall speak with new tongues. This is the word of Jesus. Now, this again is beautiful because we have to understand the cultural context and climate of that day. During that time, there were strong opinions within the Jewish community of whether these Gentile folk, do they even qualify? Can they even be included in, you know, this new community, in this family of God? Do they even qualify? The Jews hated the Samaritans for, you know, a whole host of historical reasons. They refer to them as dogs, as half-breeds. There was so much, you know, animosity between those two communities. And the Jews hated the Romans for very obvious reasons. They were oppressed, you know, for centuries. And so the Jews had all these feelings of animosity, of hatred towards this community. And they were like, we have this good thing in Jesus. The rest of the world can just burn and die. They shouldn't be even included. But with tongues, we see that this, the Spirit's endorsement and sign that these ones, regardless of their ethnicity, background, and history, have now been grafted into God's kingdom, into his family. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, as Paul says, slave nor free, nor male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. So words of Paul. Says this in commentary in Acts, the gift of tongues was given several different times. In one case, Acts 2, the man who received the gift of tongues spoke in other recognizable dialects. In Acts 10, either the gift was in other recognizable dialects or Peter and his friends received the interpretation because they heard them glorifying God. You don't know. In Acts 19, it's unclear whether tongues were understood or not. In each of the above incidents concerning tongues, the primary purpose of the gift, hear me folks, was to authenticate that new segments of people were being added to the church and that God was endorsing them by releasing this gift. Isn't this beautiful? That tongues wasn't a sign to mark believers. It was a sign that these people, whom everyone thought were unqualified, unworthy, and to be excommunicated and alienated, now because they had received this gift, the infilling of the Holy Spirit, they now belong to the family of God. That's a rich heritage you have in this gift, folks. Can you imagine that day? You know, because you speak in tongues, folks, even though I hate you and I'm supposed to hate you, but because you speak in tongues, we are now brothers and sisters. This is the sign of the Spirit. And so we gather from Acts that the gift of tongues was deeply significant for followers of Jesus for a few reasons. One, it was a sign of the reversal of the judgment of Babel. It was also a sign that the Holy Spirit had come upon an individual. It was a sign that someone had been grafted into the family of God. It was used to proclaim the gospel in other tongues and other languages. And it was also used to praise God. And that's what we see in Acts 10 and Acts 19. This is beautiful. Now, before we move on any further, we have to pause and acknowledge something. And this is something that, as a pastoral team, we want to acknowledge and call out. And there are certain beliefs, both historical and modern, about tongues, about the gift of tongues, and how it relates to the baptism of the Holy Spirit and our salvation. And there's this particular belief that we as a pastoral team want to affirm, at least in our understanding, that we believe that this isn't truthful and it's potentially harmful to the church, to the people of God. And that is the belief that if you don't speak in tongues, you're not filled with the Holy Spirit. If you don't speak in tongues, you're not filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, there is a belief that certain denominations hold that the baptism of the Holy Spirit, right, the gift of tongues specifically, is the initial outward evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That is to say, if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, it is evidence, it is seen initially, meaning first, and outward evidence, meaning seen, the gift of tongues. So in a way, to prove or to validate your baptism of the Holy Spirit, you would speak in tongues. Now, there are 22 stories in the book of Acts of people becoming followers of Jesus. And in 3 of the 22, we see them being filled with the Spirit and begin to speak in tongues. But folks, we don't see this happening in the rest of the stories, in the rest of the 19 stories. And so we can conclude that, yes, this happens to people. But no, it does not happen always, at least immediately. At least anecdotally, we will know that there are men and women who faithfully follow Jesus, who love him with all their hearts, who walk in the gift of the Spirit, who walk in the fruit of the Spirit, who are kind, merciful, gentle, who move in power, who simply, at this stage in their life, at this point, do not have the gift of tongues. Billy Graham is such an example. He did not speak in tongues until he died. He believed in tongues. He believed that the gift of Spirit was still for the church today, but he just did not speak in tongues. And I'll venture to say that Billy Graham was filled with the Holy Spirit. Many of them want to. We know people, we know Christian figures who want to have the gift of tongues, but they simply don't have it yet. Now, I believe the simple evidence in God's word is this. Hear me. God never intended spiritual language to be a proof, rather provision. He offers it as provision, a resource for prayer and praise and flourishing. He never intended for this to be some kind of badge of honor or mark of spiritual maturity. But we reduce it to evidence, to proof, when God has intended for this to be provision, a life-giving means of grace, a pathway to deeper intimacy with him. Now, this teaching of, you know, you need to have the gift of tongues in order to be proven to have the baptism of the Holy Spirit has broken so many. Some have even doubted their salvation or felt like a second-class Christian because of it. Now, I say this, and some of you might laugh, but this is a real thing that happens in churches. I've heard it at least once or twice. You know, people go like, I want the gift of tongues, but I just don't have it. And actually, someone going up to the person and say, hey, if you say, should have bought a Honda, but I bought a Kia 5 times fast, people at least think that you have the gift of tongues, or maybe you might stumble into having a gift of tongues one day. This actually happens. And people feel compelled to fake and perform in order to fit in. And we are motivated by more external pressures rather than internal longing for the Spirit's renewing work. That is the kind of culture that happens when we entertain what we believe pastorally as untruthful. Jesus didn't say, by this they will know that you're my disciples if you all speak in tongues. His standard was far higher far greater, far more costly. It was love. And yet, at the same time, we're admonished by Paul to eagerly desire spiritual gifts. The word eagerly desire can be translated to jealous, longing, seeking, or hear this, coveting, to be greedy for. It's intense longing that's followed by intense seeking. The spiritual gifts that Paul talks about is from a list of 9 in 1 Corinthians 12. It's the message of wisdom, message of knowledge, faith, gifts of healing, miraculous powers, prophecy, distinguishing between spirits, tongues, the interpretation of tongues. Now, many times when we read spiritual gifts, we think it's like an anagram kind of thing that one of us will have, you know, we'll have each have be deposited this kind of superpower, right? We'll get this kind of gift, and like, you know, for some, you know, it's prophecy, miracles, for others, it's administration. You know, so here I am praying for the sick to be healed, and there you are fiddling with Excel, and we're all good in God's kingdom. Well, but the word spiritual gifts, it comes from one word, it's pneumatikos. And the word gift doesn't even exist there. Gordon Fee, this towering intellectual Pentecostal theologian in New Testament, particularly in the words of Paul, would say that a better translation of spiritual gifts, pneumatikos, is the word spirituals, or I love this, stuff the Spirit does. Basically, it's to say that when the Spirit comes in a room upon a person, these are the things that happen. Which says to me that there are two ways to read this. It's either we go, okay, which of the 9 are mine? Come on, miracles. Or we go, Lord, my hands are open, my heart is open, my whole body is open to you, come and do as you will. All of the gifts are available for you. Which is why Paul would say, I wish and I long for all of you to speak in tongues. Why? Why did he wish for us to do so? Because tongues, extremely powerful. It's this means of grace and pathway. I want us to say this again and again, to enter mercy with God. Love him. So I'll have to end with, you know, some biblical reasons for why we pray in tongues. And many of us know the scriptures. We know that we should pray in tongues. We know what it does. But I would love to accompany the scriptures with some stories of my own, people that I know, and how, you know, it's really nourished and benefited their life. First off, in Jude chapter 1:20, it says, but beloved, building yourselves up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit. First purpose of tongues and what it does to the human soul, our body, our spirits, is that it strengthens us. It's for the purpose of strengthening. Now, folks, we live in a generation that places great emphasis on physical fitness, health, and bodybuilding. You all love to do that, right? The other day, I was looking at a passage of scripture in Leviticus. It says, all fat belong to the Lord. And I was like, I thank God I belong to the Lord more than any of y'all. But at the same time, the Holy Spirit being moved on me. I was like, exercise, Andre, get off the couch. You belong to me, but I would love you for you to remain on earth longer. That's bad exegesis, by the way. But however, even though, you know, there's this emphasis on fitness, well-being, you know, being emotionally and mentally whole, Christians may be fit in their bodies, but many of times are weak, apathetic, and vulnerable to every attack of the evil one. And God has given us the gift of tongues as a means of edification, strengthening us in our weakness, our temptation, fear, anxiety, and the like. Now, there's a missionary that many of us are familiar with, Jackie Pullinger, who had been ministering in Hong Kong since the early 1960s. It says that in the early days of her ministry, she specifically worked with gang members, prostitutes, and drug addicts who lived in a portion of Hong Kong known as the Walled City. And in her book, Chasing the Dragon, she shares many stories of addicts who were miraculously delivered through praying in the Spirit. She shares this testimony of a heroin addict named Ake, who had this habit of, you know, taking heroin for some 10 years, $100 a day kind of habit, who, through praying the Spirit, withdrew painlessly for some 10 years of addiction. Jack and Pullinger said this, that if he experienced any twinge of pain in that, you know, what's it called, withdrawal, he would pray in tongues and the pain would miraculously leave him. And then this story began to take traction. It went viral. And a little later in the book, she writes, word quickly spread along the addict grapevine. that if they were willing to believe in Jesus, they will receive some kind of power that enabled them to kick drugs painlessly. As each boy arrived, the miracle was repeated. He came to Christ and came off drugs painlessly when he began to pray in the language of the Spirit. Edification, folks. The next purpose of the tongues is for intercession. Romans 8 says this, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words." Now, there's this thing I realized in my life that whenever I wake up in the middle of the night, some 2, 3 a.m., for no particular reason, it can only be one or two. Either I had really bad pizza, or God is calling me to pray for someone. And so on the days I don't eat pizza, I mean, God, you're calling me to pray for someone. And it's just a habit, right? And so I wake up and I don't know who I'm praying for. I don't know why, you know, I'm up. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. And the only thing I can do in such moments is pray in the Spirit. And I can't begin to tell you the number of times where, you know, that would happen in the middle of the night and I'll wake up in the morning to either a piece of news that is personal or a piece of news, you know, in the world. And I knew then that that was what I was praying into and praying for. Now, there was a particular instance when I was in the US. It was my third year in ministry school. I was assigned a group of students to essentially care for and disciple. And one night, you know, in the middle of the night, I was woken up at 6 in the morning. And I was like, I don't wake up at 6. Well, these days I do because I have a one-year-old. But back then as a student, wake-up time was like 10. So 6 was like, whoa, middle of the night. So 6 a.m. I wake up, I was like, what on earth, this ungodly hour. And then I was like, why am I up? And I was like, okay, I guess I should intercede. And so I began to pray in tongues. I didn't know what I was praying for. And so I prayed in tongues for 5 minutes. And then I'm like, okay, I feel burden release. Let me go back to sleep. So I went back to sleep, and 5 minutes into my sleep, I get a call from one of my students, and he says, Andre, I got into a car accident. Can you come to the hospital now? And so I went to the hospital, and he began to tell me what happened. He was riding his bike along the road, and he got T-boned by a car. And the way he was clipped was in such a way that instead of going under the car, he was essentially spun away. It was this very small part of the bike that if you clip it just right, he essentially span away from the car, and he only had minor scratches and bruises, not even a single broken bone. And it was there and then that I knew in my heart. You might say it's coincidence, but I knew then that that was what I was praying into. That's what happens when we pray in tongues. And that's what we're invited to when we intercede with the Spirit. And so, you know, even in light of this conflict that we are seeing in our world today, sometimes I ask myself, like, how do I actually pray into this? What do I pray? Like, for Russians to die? For missiles to not explode? What do I pray for? Or do I go like, man, you know, like, these are the signs of the last days, and so I pray, but then I'm also okay with it happening because it's a sign. How do I actually pray? And it's in moments like this, I thank God for the gift of tongues because the Spirit intercedes with groanings, when I don't know how to pray, I thank God I have the gift of tongues. The next thing we're given is for praise. Ephesians 5 says this, that we speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Psalms are biblical songs from the Hebrew book of praise. Hymns can be translated as sacred songs or songs of thanksgiving and praise that are written. And spiritual songs is the word pneumaticus, which literally translates to songs of the Spirit. Biblical songs, songs that are written, songs of the Spirit. Charles Wesley wrote this famous hymn titled "Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." And it was said that this line was inspired by his mentor, who said this, that had I 1,000 tongues, I would praise him with them all. Now this hyperbole captured his mentor's deep desire to express a deep love for God, to express to him a kind of worship that transcends the limitations of human language. I wonder if you have ever had a moment in worship where you go, God, I just want to give you so much praise. I just want to express my gratitude to you. And the words that are up on screen just don't cut it. And what happens? God has given us the gift of tongues to express to him in a way that one tongue cannot fully kind of express. In tongues, we pretty much enter into that song, "Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing." psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Now, the last thing that we're invited to through the praying of tongues is into communion. Into communion is to experience a depth of intimacy with Him. I'm running out of time, but I'd love to end off with a quote from N.T. Wright. He says this, "Tongues is experienced as a stream of praise in which, though the speaker may not be able to articulate what precisely is being said, sense of love for God, of adoration and gratitude, wells up and overflows." This last line, it is the private language of love. Think about it, is this a language that only you, only God comprehends? No other one is able to understand this. Is this private language of love? Can you feel the depth of communion and the mercy that is possible through this pathway and gift? And so as we end, some of you do not have the gift of tongues this day. And you want it, you would love to have it, but you don't know how to get started. And you know, as far as I see, you know, I ask many people, like, how do you receive the gift of tongues? What actually happened? What took place? How do you posture yourself to do it? And it always starts off with a longing, a desire. As you read the words of scripture, I long for this, I want this. And then it goes into seeking. As Paul would say, eagerly desire the spiritual gifts. It may look like receiving prayer, which we will make available at the front after service. It may look like, you know, posturing yourself in a posture of tarry before God. For some, it's in a service. For others, it's when you are alone. I didn't receive the gift of tongues in a service. It was in my bedroom when I was on my own that I started to speak in other tongues. It's also to move into a posture of openness, to receive, to be open with the Spirit doing stuff in you that transcends your mind and your understanding. You know, I wanted to show this video of Francis Chan sharing at a gathering in IHOP about how he doesn't speak in tongues, but he wants to and he loves everyone as brothers and sisters. I want to show that as a means of illustration. And as I was searching for that clip, I chanced upon this interview that he did last year. And he shared that he was on a phone call with a theologian that has written extensively on tongues. And on that phone call, he received the gift of tongues. And so Francis Chan speaks in tongues today. And the same interviewer did another interview with Max Lucado last year. And Max Lucado shared the story that when he was 64, 2 years ago, he was praying in the morning. He was saying, "Holy Spirit, what more? What more can I have of you?" And it was in that prayer he began to speak in tongues at 64 years old. Openness. Open to all that the Spirit wants to do. Last thing, after longing, seeking, receiving, is to put it into practice, folks. To do it frequently. Paul would say to Timothy, fan into flame the gift of God. Fan into flame. It says this, that when we don't put it in practice, that fire that once burned bright and clear begins to diminish, begins to grow weak. And so, folks, can I invite you to stand as the band comes back up on stage? So sorry, I ran a bit over, but I hope that blessed you. Now, there's this view surrounding tongues that tongues are not for today in that language. And it's a cessationist view, meaning that the gifts of the Spirit are no longer active. They no longer are needed for the church in this day. It says in 1 Corinthians 13 that tongues will cease. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But Paul will clarify that text further in verse 10 when he says this, that when the perfect comes, when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror, then we shall see face to face. So it tells me this, that when Jesus comes, when we meet Him face to face, these gifts are no longer necessary. They are no longer needed. For what we know in part, we will know in full on that day. Tongues will cease, but not now. It ceases when the perfect comes. But it also says to me this, that there's this limited window of opportunity given to the people of God. Our time on earth is the only time that we get to exercise and walk in this gift. This gift that transcends our understanding, our comprehension, that is so confusing and mysterious, Jesus gives to us. Why? Because it tutors our hearts and minds in dependency, in surrender, and in trust. That is the gift that God gives to us through the tongues. It's not just a mere prayer language. It's so much more than that. It's to experience a depth of intimacy with Him. And so as we close this morning, I'd love to pray for you. And if you feel that this is rushed, you'd love to tarry, and maybe you don't have the gift of tongues and you want to have it, the prophetic team will be available for you on my right at the end of service. I'll be there to pray for you as well. Let us close this time. Spirit, we thank you for this gift. This gift that you've given to us, not for our harm, our confusion, or embarrassment. Father, we recognize that you are the one who gives to your people good gifts. Every good gift comes from you. And so we want to first of all say that tongues, this gift of the Spirit is a good gift. It's for our benefit, it's for our joy. And so Lord, we pray even now, Holy Spirit, come upon this room. For ones who do not have this gift and long for, I pray now, Spirit, come upon all flesh. Now descend upon these bodies. Cause them to be filled with this prayer language. Let the rivers of the living God bubble within their bodies even now. Come, Holy Spirit, fall upon all flesh. As you did on Pentecost, as you did in the beginnings of the church, fall upon us now, we pray. May you be filled with the presence of the living God. May we be filled with this gift of tongues that we may commune with you in a deep way, God. Come, Holy Spirit. Come on, begin to sing to God. Psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Let's sing to God. Sing to Jesus. Yes, Jesus.
And overflow in this place. Fill the hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter.
To lean in and, you know, respond to God on your own and, you know, pray and worship Him in tongues. And for those of us, as Pastor Andre said, you know, we invite you to respond and have someone pray with you. You want to contend for a breakthrough. Our prophetic team is here ready to pray with you. And then just, you know, lean into this. And let me just pray as we close our service today. God, we thank you for all that you have put in your word and scripture for us, Lord, that we pray, even as we've heard this, God, in many of us, Lord, we're just thankful that you not just reminding us, but so much significance and just this gift of grace and your spirit that you've given to us, your people. And so we thank you for this word. We thank you that we have this time and we can respond together as your people, as a body. We thank you for this privilege of worshiping you in the spirit and praising you in the spirit. And so with this, we say yes to you. And the rest of the days this week, Lord, continue to just teach us to lean in and be open to what your spirit wants to do in us and through us, Lord, and to be a blessing in the world where you send us to. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. 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 Praise God. Yeah, hallelujah. Please be seated. Yeah. Just a quick reminder, we've got seat booking, ticket booking for next Sunday service starts 12 p.m. today. So head over to the website to book your seats. Also, remain seated. Our volunteers will be dismissing you by section. All right. Have a great Sunday.
For all eternity, there will be a day when all will bow before Him. There will be a day when death will join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. With one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb.